Hi, my name is Terry Demler, and I'm a parishioner here at St. Michael and All Angels Episcopal Church in Dallas, Texas. I want to share my story with you today and the impact of something that I didn't know has had on it and my spiritual journey. Several years ago here at St. Michael, when my husband and I were pretty new parishioners here, there was a seminar, and the seminar was held in conjunction with the Catholic Diocese here in Dallas and the Episcopal Diocese. And the topic of this seminar was human trafficking. I didn't know anything about human trafficking. So Mark and I decided to attend. And when we did, we learned things that we had no idea existed, not only here in our country, but in our neighborhoods. So afterwards, we kept thinking, what can we do? How can we help with this issue of human trafficking? And it was very difficult to come up with something because I still needed to learn a lot more about it. During this time after the seminar, Mark and I were on a church trip, and we were fortunate enough to meet Archbishop David Moxon. And at the time, he was the director of the Anglican Center in Rome. He and several leaders of other faiths had just recently had a meeting about this whole issue of human trafficking. And they had pledged together on a global level to work on this issue. So sitting and talking with David about his knowledge of this issue and how they were going to go forward helped me again understand a little bit more, but there was still a lot that I needed to learn. So after we got back, I kept thinking, and I just couldn't pin something down, but yet I had this nagging feeling. It was a physical nagging, if you will, something that I just could not figure out, could not put my finger on exactly what it was. And then finally, one day, I'm like, oh, I know what this nagging is, this nagging and this tugging at my heart. Not only is it the issue of human trafficking that I had been exposed to, but it was God telling me that I needed to do something about it. So as soon as I realized what I was being asked to do, I started down that road of, okay, not sure what it's going to be, but let's do this. I went to have a discussion with our associate priest who was over mission and outreach here at church. We talked about how do you start a ministry, and we talked about this issue of trafficking. Hunter gave us a lot of great ideas about how to start the ministry and try to pull some people together. So we decided that on a Sunday, we would put out some advertising around the church to get together and ask people to come together to talk about this issue of human trafficking and to learn more about it. Well, we were really pleased that a lot of people showed up that all had the same heart that we did for this issue. So since then, we have gotten together, and that was several years ago, and all the people that came to that meeting are still part of our ministry today. During that first year, my husband and I went to, a large symposium at SMU. There, we listened to a panel of survivors of human trafficking. And these women had these stories to tell about their lives that, for me, was very hard to get my head around, basically, to understand that someone would have to go through what they had gone through. One of these women was Rebecca Charleston. And after the seminar, I went up to her to introduce myself, and I wanted to just talk to her about her story. I was telling her what we were beginning to do here at St. Michael and wanted her to come and speak here at the church again so that people would be able to have a face on this issue of human trafficking. Since that time, we've worked with Rebecca often, and I am very happy to share that I consider her a good friend. She's an amazing woman. And right now, I'd like you to meet Rebecca.
At the age of 17, I ran away from home. After a few months of living homeless on the streets and using drugs, I found myself working in a strip club. And I hated what I was doing. And I wanted to get away from there. I should have been in high school. I ran into this guy that seemed cute, and I thought he would be my boyfriend, and I thought I would get out. And he began trafficking me. And I had multiple traffickers over the course of 10 years. I wasn't able to escape until the federal authorities finally became involved. I was arrested and sentenced because I was too scared to tell on my trafficker. It wasn't until he turned himself in to serve that same prison sentence that I knew I had 20 months to start my life over before he hunted me down and killed me like he always told me he would. I kind of floundered for a while. I went right back to that 17-year-old girl I was when I met him and began experimenting with drugs again and not processing any of the trauma that I had been through. I blamed myself. I thought it was my choice. I thought somehow that I just made really bad choices and that I got what I deserved. Not looking back and seeing, no, that 17-year-old girl that met that 37-year-old man and I was manipulated and abused and controlled from day one, that was never my choice. It wasn't until I became pregnant in 2011 that I finally realized I needed to change my life. I wanted to come back to Texas, and so God made a way. And I moved back to Texas on January 7th, 2012. 2 hours after I got here, I went to church. They showed me grace and love, gave me warm hugs, and taught me how to love myself for the first time.
As Terry has conveyed, the idea of human trafficking is unbelievable in so many ways and is a very emotional subject to understand and certainly to deal with. I, along with Terry, attended that symposium in 2015 here, actually in this space we're speaking from today. It was certainly an educational piece, but we came to be helpers. We knew nothing about the subject, and you might say I went from an usher to an advocate in just a few hours. This was obviously a very inspirational piece to both of us. Now, in the information that the Reverend Eric Lyles published about my story, he asked us to do two different things, and one of those was to get involved in at least one small group ministry. And the other thing was to look at our own spiritual autobiography and begin to write down what that means to us and what our faith journey looks like. I accepted this challenge, and I realized that Project Moses was a big milestone within my spiritual journey. Also realizing with Project Moses that understanding the complexity and the nuances of human trafficking was very important if we were to not only begin a ministry here in this church, but begin to help survivors, which was our goal from the start. What we would like to do now is just take a look at a video that Project Moses developed to help educate us.
What is human trafficking? Human trafficking is modern-day slavery. It is the exploitation of a person through force, fraud, or coercion. Human smuggling and human trafficking are different crimes. Human smuggling is the illegal movement of a person across a border. Human trafficking is the illegal exploitation of a person. Human trafficking is about exploitation, not transportation. Human trafficking is a highly profitable crime and a violation of human rights. It can happen to anyone. Victims can be any age, race, or gender. But one thing they share, they are vulnerable to being exploited. There are different types of human trafficking, including sex trafficking, forced labor, and domestic servitude. Sex trafficking victims are manipulated or forced against their will to engage in sex acts for money. Sex traffickers might use violence, threats, manipulation, or the promise of love and affection to lure victims. Forced labor takes on many forms. Victims are made to work for little or no pay. Very often they are forced to manufacture or grow the products we use or consume every day. Victims of forced labor can be found in factories and farms, doing construction work, and more. Victims of domestic servitude are hidden in plain sight. Traffickers take their identification papers and travel documents to limit their freedom. They are prisoners, working as nannies, maids, and domestic help. Human trafficking is a hidden crime. Victims might be afraid to come forward, or we may not recognize the signs, even if it is happening right in front of us.
This video conveys the realities and horrors of the crime. In 2016, the state of Texas commissioned a study by the Institute on Domestic Violence and Sexual Assault at the University of Texas in Austin. The report was titled Human Trafficking by the Numbers. And this revealed some startling facts about human trafficking in Texas. Let me share some of those with you at this time. Approximately 79,000 minors and youths are victims of human trafficking in the state of Texas. In addition to that, an estimated 234,000 workers are victims of labor trafficking in Texas. Combined, this means that over 313,000 victims of human trafficking are in our state. The economic impact of this on our state is also astounding. The estimated number is over $6.6 billion in cost of social services to care for survivors and to prosecute cases in our courts. Unfortunately, these numbers also mean one other thing, and that is that Texas is the number two state in the United States for human trafficking activity. To bring this even a little closer to home, there's an estimated 400 teens trafficked on the streets of Dallas every night. And the sex trafficking industry in Dallas is a $99 million industry annually. These startling facts led us to an obvious question. How can we, Terry and I, in our ministry and the church, help to fight this crime? In 2016, our ministry was formed as part of the mission and outreach here at St. Michael's. Our mission was established to highlight the truths of human trafficking and to share the light of Christ with its survivors. This mission continues to guide us today and helps us focus on the areas of advocacy, education, and building partnerships throughout the community. Now that we had decided to develop this ministry, we began to think about what to call this ministry, and the deliverance of the slaves out of Egypt gave us an inspiration for the name Project Moses. In addition to that, a verse from Isaiah gave us the direction for action.
And that verse is, "Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Who shall I send and who will go for us?' And I said, "Here am I, send me."
What I wish I knew back then was that it wasn't my fault, because I blamed myself. But now I know no child deserves to be victimized or exploited ever at all.
No longer can we say we didn't know. Please join us in our fight against the evils of human trafficking.
Today we have talked about I Didn't Know, the first piece of our talk about Project Moses. Next week, we'd like to talk about getting to work, what Project Moses does, and how you can help.